Hallelujah. Praise the Lord, everybody. Praise the Lord, everybody. We invite you to stand on your feet as we begin praise and worship all over the building. We thank God. Anybody glad to be in the house of the Lord today? I said, anybody glad you in the land of the living? You made the wake-up list. Anybody glad you're on the right side of the dirt? Somebody talk to me today. I came to give God a real praise today. Welcome to Brookland Baptist Church. We are so honored that you decided to worship with us on today. We've come for no other reason than to give our God the praise that he deserves. Anybody know that God is worthy today? I said, does anybody know God is worthy? I mean, you look so good. You got a reason to praise God. My God. Hallelujah. Let your family and your friends know I'm in the house of God to give God some good praise. Hallelujah. My God. And even before we sing this opening song, I spoke with a friend of mine this morning that was dealing with cancer, and they had chemotherapy, and now they're doing radiation. And I asked her, I said, how you doing today? And she said, you know what? The radiation hasn't been too bad. And I told her, you know why? And she said, why? I said, because the worst is over. I came to let you know that the worst is over, and you got a good reason to give God a good praise right there. Somebody shout hallelujah to the Lord. I came to let you know it's only going to get better from here. I said it's only going to get better from here. So we came to give God hallelujah. I feel God already. I came to bless him. Look at somebody, tell him, I don't know what you came to do, but I came to praise the Lord. I came to bless him. Hallelujah. Every praise is to our God. I want y'all to sing it like it's Sunday morning, like you're glad about it. Come on, put your hands together right there. Come on, it's all right to clap your hands. We came to lift him. Wonderful, thank you. Come on, all over the room, let's sing it together. Hallelujah, yeah. Every praise is to our God. Every word of worship with one accord. Every praise, every praise is to our God. Oh, sing hallelujah to our God. Glory, hallelujah is to our God. Every praise.
Yes, he is. God, my Savior.
goodness of Jesus. All he's done for me. Because he's a great God. Everybody all over the room say, say God is great.
God is great.
Do you believe it? He's greater too. All over the room say God is
great.
Everybody shout, oh. Get out of here. Everybody shout, God is good.
God is good.
Shout, oh.
great and greatly to be praised. Good morning. If you are able to stand on your feet, please stand for our morning prayer. Hallelujah. Father, this morning we come corporately thanking you for your sovereignty. We come, Father, with hearts full of praise, thanking you for bringing us through another week and bringing us safely through today. Father, we pray your anointing presence to fall fresh, Father God, on this waiting congregation, Father God, and even in the Brooklyn beyond. We pray that you will just bless us corporately, and Father God, bless us individually for whatever we need. Father God, we pray for your servant, Father God, who will ascend the pulpit and who will deliver a fresh word. Please allow your servant, Father God, to deliver the word with power and conviction. And the message, Father God, will fall on hearts, Father God, fertile hearts, Father God, and we will use the message to take it through us the week and beyond. Father God, please bless our pastor and associate pastors and the officials of this church. Father, we know that you are a promise keeper, way maker, healer, and a light in darkness. Father God, this morning we know that there are people who are, there are those who have lost loved ones. Father God, we pray for them. Father God, we pray for those who are sick. Father God, we know that you are a healer. We pray that you heal them. And Father God, bless the caregivers that will take care of them. And Father God, we know that you are a way maker. So Father God, whatever is needed today, Father God, we pray that you will just deliver for us today. Father God, and then you commanded us to pray for our leaders. Father God, we pray for our leaders, Father God, who are tasked with the mantle of leadership. Father God, we pray their safety and their wisdom. And Father, now for the rest of us, service is the rent we pay for our service, for our place here on this earth. Father God, you've called us to be light, and you've called us to be salt. Help us not to lose our saltiness. And Father God, help us to go out into this dark world, spreading your light and being salt to the name, to the glory, to your glory and to your honor. To all praise and all glory be your name. In Jesus' name we pray.
Oh, yeah.
short me and he want me with him.
Verses 9 through 14 from the King James Version. And it reads, "And they said unto him, Where is Sarah thy wife? And he said, Behold, in the tent. And he said, I will certainly return unto thee according to the time of life. And lo, Sarah thy wife shall have a son. And Sarah heard it in the tent door, which was behind him. Now Abraham and Sarah were old and well stricken in age. And it ceased to be with Sarah after the manner of women. Therefore, Sarah laughed within herself, saying, After I am waxed old, shall I have pleasure, my Lord being old also. And the Lord said unto Abraham, Wherefore did Sarah laugh, saying, Shall I of a surety bear a child, which am old? Is anything too hard for the Lord? At the time appointed, I will return unto thee, according to the time of life, and Sarah shall have a son. For that's how I've read Genesis 18, verses 9 through 14. The word of God for the people, God. Thanks be all to God.
Amen, amen. Thank you so much. That was Ethan Button. He's a 16-year-old 10th grader at Sumter High School. Let's give God a hand praise for this young man. Amen. Before I start with the welcome, I do have one very special announcement. If you are parked on Craft Hill Street, we're asking that you please at this time cordially just leave out and move your car. This is a request, and you should have some directions out there, but Secret Service will now need you to move your cars. So again, if you're parked on Craft Hill Street, you will now need to just quietly exit and please return, but we need you to move your cars, okay? All right, so praise the Lord, everybody. I am standing before you, just giving God all the glory. And I have a, if it's okay with co-pastor, Pastor Jackson, just a brief thing to say. I just have to give God the glory on this morning because you're looking at a miracle, amen? God is faithful, he is a healer. When that song went forth that God is great and he is greatly to be praised, that is my testimony on this morning. And I'm here to tell you that I am convinced that you're in the right place at the right time to receive just what God has for you on this morning. Because you see, several months ago, I was in this sanctuary and I received a message in my chart telling me that even my post-surgical reviews were all messed up, that my spine was narrowing, that I wouldn't be able to walk, that I needed to see the doctor immediately the next day. And at the moment that fear started to grip me, Pastor Charles B. Jackson Jr. said, the same God back then is the same God right now. How many of you know in that moment I needed that word? That's how come I can stand here and I might just take my shoes off just to tell you that God is good. He's a healer. He knows what you need to hear when you need to hear it. He knows what you need to receive when you need to receive it. And just because the doctor said I might not be able to walk, let me show you something.
I'm gonna make it.
Truly, he's worthy. For all of our visitors at this time, if it's your first time visiting Brooklyn, we'd just like you to stand for a minute. But our special visitors, hold on for a second. Before our first-time visitors, if you're here, please stand. Our ushers has a special packet for you. Welcome to Brooklyn. Amen. You're in the right place at the right time. For those of you who are watching via live streaming, we ask that you pay attention to the QR code, and our pastor, our Reverend Daryl King here, he's going to contact you. We'd like for you to scan that QR code, and we want you to provide us your information so that we can reach out to you and show you just a little bit more love. Amen? Amen. And at this time, I'd like to welcome our special guest, and this means a lot to me. I won't say why, but y'all know. At this time, we would like to welcome our special guests joining us in the gathered church here, the Columbia Panhellenic Council, comprised of representatives of the local D9 sororities and fraternities at this time. I'd like to ask and welcome President Cedric Wright to the podium. He has a very special presentation at this time. Amen.
First, give an honor to God, to Pastor Dr. Charles B. Jackson, Sr., Reverend Charles B. Jackson, Jr., First Lady Robin Jackson, the official board and members of this great church. Good morning.
Good morning.
Indeed, I am very excited to be able to stand before you to articulate how honored the members of the National Panhellenic Council of Columbia are to worship and celebrate Greek unity here today. Will all the members of the Divine Nine family please stand? Thank you so much. Will all the members of the National Panhellenic Council of Columbia please stand? On behalf of this great organization, we would like to present your youth ministry with a check in the amount of $500. Yeah. We hope that this donation will be used to continue the stellar services that you all offer to enhance, educate, and promote the vision that has been established. We thank you for allowing us to worship with Brooklyn Baptist on today, and we look forward to working and forming a partnership with you all in the future. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much. On behalf of our pastors, our co-pastors, Pastor Charles B. Jackson Sr., Charles B. Jackson Jr., and our entire Brooklyn family, we thank you. Now, at this time, we'd like to invite your attention to the screens. We have a very special presentation for you from our Brooklyn Beyond team. Some important messages in our segment that we'd like to call your attention to. It's called The Happenings at the Land.
Good morning, Brooklyn Baptist family. To those of you who are in the gathered church as well as those online, thank you so much for joining us this morning in worship. My name is Gigi, and this is Happenings at the Land. If you miss anything that I'm about to discuss with you in this segment this morning, feel free to go to our website, www.brooklynbaptist.org, and you can find everything that I'm going to be speaking about today. Don't forget to like our Facebook page, as well as join and subscribe our YouTube family. And also, if you want to catch up with Brooklyn on your smartphone, you can go to your Google Play Store or the App Store, and you can find the Brooklyn Baptist app. Bible study with Pastor Jackson starts on Wednesday, January 31st in person at 12 noon and 6 p.m. It will take place in the multi-purpose room in the Christian Learning Center. The Brooklyn Banquet and Conference Center celebrates Valentine's Day with comedian Nikita B. We invite all singles and couples to come celebrate. Tickets are on sale now, so make sure to contact Kay Allen Campbell at 803-744-7906. February is Black History Month, and we need your help. Please contact Kay Allen Campbell at 803-744-7906 to volunteer for the committee. Young Pastors and Leaders Conference is almost here. It starts Monday, February 5th, with an opening session from our founder and pastor, Dr. Charles B. Jackson Sr. at 7 p.m. We are asking you to please go to the Brooklyn website, again, www.brooklynbaptist.org, and register now. The Brooklyn Brotherhood will have its first breakfast meeting of the new year, Saturday, February 3rd, 2024, in the dining hall located in the Christian Learning Center. Jim Felder is our special guest, and there is no charge for breakfast, but you must RSVP. All of the information is on our website, www.brooklynbaptist.org. Our Boy Scout Troop number 74 will be participating in their annual Super Bowl for Caring on Sunday, February 11th, 2024. Please see all of the information on our website on how to be a special part of this year's event. Thank you guys so much for joining me this morning to hear about all of the happenings at the Land. If you missed anything that I spoke about, again, you can go to www.brooklynbaptist.org. And remember to get out and vote. Your vote matters. The Democratic primary opens Saturday, February 3rd, and the Republican primary is going to be Saturday, February 24th. Now let's head back over to the main sanctuary as we prepare to worship God in giving.
Welcome back. To all of our generous givers and those of you who've made so many contributions in the year 2023, we have a special announcement for you at this time. Our 2023 contribution statements were sent via email on Thursday, January the 25th, 2024. Please check your emails, including spam and junk mail, for your Brooklyn Baptist Church giving statement. If you do not have a valid email on file, your statement was mailed to you at the street address that we have here on file. Please contact the Finance Department at 803-796-7525, extension 152, for any questions that you may have concerning your statement for this year. Please know that we appreciate your contributions and your continuous support here at Brooklyn. Sincerely, the Brooklyn Finance Team, and of course, our co-pastors, Pastor Charles B. Jackson Sr. and Charles B. Jackson Jr. At this time, it is giving time in the house of the Lord. Amen? Amen. I heard while I was out on sick leave that you just can't beat God's giving no matter how hard you try. Amen. The more you give, he does what? He's going to give back to you. So today, I encourage you to just give, and you will be blessed. Amen. Amen. Now, there are five ways that you can give of God's tithes and your offerings. There is text to give. If you just pay attention to our screens, it's up there as well. Our Shelby Next app, you can download that on your smartphone. You can also drop your offering at the credit union, at the Brooklyn Credit Union, located right here off Sunset Boulevard. You may also give online at www.brooklynbaptist.org and click on the giving tab. If you're, while you're present with us today, you would like to give here, please know that you can do so by dropping your offerings off at the portals in the back near the ushers. Amen? Amen. Let us pray. Most precious and heavenly Father, we just thank you for being our good and great God. Thank you for being the giver of every good gift. We thank you and we give of our hearts today, Lord God, and we give of your tithes and our offerings. We thank you that you promised in your word, Lord God, that your promises are in you, yes and amen. We thank you, Lord God, as we give today, Lord God, so that your kingdom will grow and your kingdom will expand, that you will enlarge our territories, Lord God, that you will expand our spiritual and natural realm, Lord God, with your divine wisdom and your wealth. We decree and we declare during this time of prayer that we will experience God's favor like never before. We thank you, Lord God, because you've called us to give. We know that you're going to provide. We thank you for the provision of manifestation in our creativity, innovative solutions, cutting-edge technologies, inventions, new business ventures, strategies, insights, advancements in our careers. Father, we thank you, Lord God, for even open doors for ministry opportunities. We thank you for new clients, new contracts, Lord God, divine networks, and multiple streams of revenue, Lord God. Father, we thank you that we're not just ordinary, we're not just extraordinary, but we're legendary because you called us to do so. We thank you for every good and perfect gift. We thank you that you loaded us daily with the benefits. And Father, for those who would like to give and they want to know how they can give, Father, we thank you for those destiny helpers that will teach and give them a word that they'll understand how to give. Give them wisdom to obtain wealth and a heart to give in Jesus' name. We thank you right now, Lord God, for your manservant, Lord God, our co-pastor, Pastor Charles B. Jackson Jr. We thank you, Lord God, for the anointing, Lord God, that makes preaching easy. We thank you, Lord God, that you've already put a word on the inside of him, Lord God, that he will deliver to us, Lord God, that we will receive, we will hear, and we will do and be blessed. In Jesus' name, Lord God, for everywhere we have not prayed, Lord God, you already know our needs. So we thank you for meeting every need now in the name of Jesus. We give you all the glory. We give you all the honor. We lift our hearts and we thank you in advance. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Just trying to do a poll of the room. Is there anybody in here that loves Jesus for real? I mean, you love him, love him. Do I have anybody that's not ashamed of the fact that you love my God? Hallelujah. I love him. The song says, Lord, I love you more than anything. My cousin Imari is coming to lift this song up. Can you all give her a hand as she comes? Hallelujah.
For everything that he's done for you. I love you, Jesus, for waking you up this morning and letting you travel the dangerous highways without letting no hurt, harm, or danger come upon you. I love you, Jesus, and we thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord.
I lift my hands in total adoration unto you.
Song, come on, sing it with me. Yes,
say I lift my hands in total adoration unto you. Say that I
I
Anybody here really love the Lord? I think I'm looking at a few thousand people here who really love the Lord this morning. You know, there are some precious promises from God in His Word for those who really love Him. He said He'll work all things together for your good. He said, eye hasn't seen, ear hasn't heard, it hasn't entered into the hearts of man what great things God has in store for those who love Him. Let me ask you again, anybody here really love the Lord? How many love my Jesus? Because he first loved us. What a mighty God we serve. Thank you, praise team. Thank you, praise team, for reminding us that there's nothing wrong with falling in love with Jesus. How many know He won't let you down? He won't disappoint you. He won't hurt you. You can fall in love with Jesus and know that everything is all right. Come on, let's praise God today. God is good. God is so good. Dr. Jackie Jones Brown, thank you for leading us in worship this morning. And we praise God for your testimony. You're right. The same God then. He's the same God right now. Thank you so very, very much. It's certainly a blessing to have all of the members of the Divine Nine in worship with us today. Panhellenic Council of Columbia, thank you for being in worship with us today and for a very generous donation to the church. May God continue to bless the Divine Nine with His divine presence as well. Amen. Come on, let's give all the members. I feel like doing a roll call right now. You know, HBCUs, Alpha Lambda, Spring 98. You know, HBCUs, we do roll calls. Amen. But it's so good to have all of you in worship with us. And I see probably about 993 of us did not get the memo this morning. But in observance of our young people, our teens in the Vibe Church, today is their Sneaker Sunday. So that's why you might see about three or four of us in our sneakers this morning. Amen. They're celebrating Sneaker Sunday, and I like that touch. I like that vibe that they have over in Vibe Church. So, no, I'm not trying to make a fashion statement. Yeah, I'm not trying to change y'all, no. We're just connecting with our young people, with our teenagers today. Amen. Amen. Praise God. But there is a word from the Lord, and I want to thank that young brother for reading that passage of scripture into our hearing, and I want to compliment those navy blue Jordan 3s he's got on right now. Those were tough, man. Sneakerheads know what I'm talking about right now. Amen, amen. But thank you for reading that passage. Out of that passage that was read into our hearing, I just want to shine a sermonic spotlight on verses 13 and 14 of that 18th chapter of Genesis. Genesis chapter 18, verses 13 and 14. They read on this wise as it is recorded in the New King James Version. And the Lord said to Abraham, why did Sarah laugh, saying, shall I surely bear a child since I am old? Is anything too hard for the Lord? At the appointed time, I will return to you according to the time of life, and Sarah shall have a son. The word of God. Is anything too hard for the Lord? I want to tag the title to this text and preach for the next little while about the answer is still the same. Dr. Jones Brown, the answer is still the same. We humbly solicit your prayers. Those of you or anyone who knows me best, not as Pastor Jr., but Charles Jr., those who know me in a personal way, they know that there is very little that can happen in my life that causes me to become worried or bothered too much. There's not much that worries me, causes me to become bothered. I've learned, y'all, to control what you can control. Control only what I can control and leave the rest up to the Lord. For it's been said that if you try to control what you cannot control, then it will end up controlling you. And so I've realized that the key to a worry-free, less stressful, more peaceful life is to understand the difference between being controlling and being in control. Hear God today. Being controlling versus being in control. When one is being controlling, they try to control everything inside and mostly outside of themselves. They take on everybody else's problems and makes them their problems. They impose their wills and their ways of thinking and doing things on everyone else's will and ways of thinking or doing things. And if they are not able to bring about assimilation by manipulation, then they criticize and condemn the other person or party for not doing it the way they would do it. And in essence, they find themselves constantly out of control. Being controlling. But being in control is something different. Being in control is simply having a handle on your own reactions and responses, thus always being in control of yourself, even when everything else around you seems to be out of control. You control only what you can control. A wise man once said that life is 10% what happens to us, 90% of how we respond to it. And truth is, y'all, this is a rather simple resolve to arrive at in life when we can come to an affirmative answer to this one simple question concerning the character and the ability of our Almighty God. Are you praying with me this morning? You see, one of the reasons it's very difficult for me to worry or to stress over anything in life is because I truly believe that God can do absolutely anything he wants to do and I need him to do. Did you hear what I said? I said God can do anything. 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 And this is not just being delusional or overly optimistic. This is not having what's called fanciful faith, where your faith is out of touch with reality. This thinking that God can do anything is not being an idealist and in love with the idea of a sovereign God, but this is based on a question that God raised all throughout the Bible and proves the answer to every day of our lives. Let's look at it here. In this text, Abraham and Sarah are in the twilight years of their life. And the promise that God made to Abraham decades ago still hasn't come true. God assured Abraham upon making a covenant with him as the father of his chosen people that he would bless him and Sarah with a male child. And he would be the patriarch of a great nation of people who would be as numerous as the stars in the night sky. Yet here they are. Abraham is 99 years old, and Sarah is 98. And they are practically and humanly incapable of conceiving a child. However, the Lord sent word to Sarah that she would bring forth a child now, even though she's been barren for years and was well in her senior ages. But Sarah laughed at the mere thought of this. And so God then asked Abraham, why is Sarah laughing? Why is she laughing? He seems to be saying, in essence, she must not know who I am. She must not know what I'm capable of. And then he raises the question, Dr. King. He says, is anything too hard for the Lord? Is anything too hard for God? And how many know it's only one answer that could have been given when you think about who's asking the question? And the Lord told me to tell somebody today that just like it was thousands of years ago, the answer is still the same. It's still the same today. Anybody want to try to give it an answer? He raised the question again in Jeremiah 32 when the prophet questioned how God could allow his people to be taken into captivity by the Babylonians, but would eventually deliver them again once they learned their lesson. He asked Jeremiah in verse 26, is there anything too hard for me? Again, no answer was needed because the answer is still the same. I ask again, anybody want to try to give an answer? Well, the answer is obviously an emphatic, absolutely not. I want to press that on your spirit this morning. Absolutely not. There is nothing too hard for God. Absolutely not. It was the answer then for Abraham and Sarah. It was the answer for Moses at the Red Sea. It was the answer for Joshua at the Jordan River. It was the answer for Gideon against the Midianites. It was the answer for David against Goliath. It was the answer for Daniel in the lion's den. It was the answer for the three Hebrew boys in the fiery furnace. It was the answer for Ezekiel in a valley of dry bones. It was the answer at the wedding in Cana of Galilee. The answer for the two blind men. The answer for Jairus' daughter. The answer for the lame man at the gate. The answer for the woman with the issue of blood. The answer for the man with the withered hand. The answer for Mary and Martha at Lazarus' grave. The answer for 5,000 men plus women and children. It was the answer for Paul and Silas in a Philippian jail. And it was the answer for Jesus on the third day of the crucifixion. Is there anything too hard for God? It was the answer then, and it's the answer still today. Absolutely not. There is nothing too hard for God. Nothing too hard. Absolutely not. There's nothing too hard for God. But in case you're still a little doubtful like Sarah, I want to leave with you three words to really settle this sentiment in your spirit this morning and 20 forward. The first word is beware. Let me hear you say beware. Beware, beware. You see, the reason the answer to this question is not a matter of idealism or fantasy is because it is based on the realization that there are things in this life that will go wrong, and everything will not work according to our plans. Talk to us, Holy Ghost. You see, we live in a fallen world. A fallen world where evil is everywhere. Danger is always lurking. Trouble is around every corner. And the devil is always busy trying to cause doubt, division, discouragement, despair, delusion, and depression. How many know that's his job? That's his job. And sadly so, it are these types of feelings that cause many of us to stress and worry about things that are really out of our control. But God is saying here, beware. In other words, be mindful. Keep your eyes open. Stay woke. In this life, things are going to go wrong. Plans are going to go awry. Promises are going to go unfulfilled. But what you've got to understand is that you've heard it before. A promise delayed is not a promise denied. I'm in this text this morning. God told Abraham, after he asked if anything was too hard for him, he said, at the set time, I need you to put a bookmark there. You need to put a pen here. I will return to you in due season. I love how the King James Version put it, though. It says, according to the time of life, Sarah shall have a son. I said, according to the time of life, Sarah shall have a son. What is God saying here, Pastor Junior? Well, you see, God does not operate on our time. Pastor Senior alludes to this all the time. We live, you see, on chronos time, from which we get the term chronology. God, however, moves in what the Greeks call kairos time. Kairos time. That's why the psalmist affirmed that 1,000 years in our sight is but one day in his. Chronos versus kairos. God does not move according to our timetable. We don't control this life. We can only control how we respond in this life. Oh, God, I know all of us, particularly those of Divine Nine, we had to memorize that poem by William Hemley. I am the captain of my fate, the master of my, I think that's a little theologically off there, however. We don't control this life. We can only control how we respond in this life. Do y'all hear what I'm saying? I did not give you life. You did not give me life. Sure, you may have contributed to bringing someone into this world. My mother brought me into this world, but God enables us to live. Hear what I'm saying today. And so we cannot dictate everything that happens in this life. God gave us life. And God is sovereign and in complete control of the times of this life. That's why the Lord giveth and the Lord taketh away. Now, that doesn't mean, stay with me here, that we are to just sit around like fatalists and just accept everything that happens and leave everything up to fate and chance and happenstance. By no means. But what we do is, we work while we wait. We press on while we pray. We witness while we watch. We try to be better while we trust in God. And through it all, along the way, like I said last Sunday, we let God lead the way. We let God show the way. We let God teach the way and be the way while we follow and walk in the way. I tell you, God is able to do anything. But in the meantime, he says, beware. The enemy doesn't like it. The enemy can't stand it and will try to prevent everything God is trying to bring to pass. So he says, beware. Watch God. For God is greater than he that's in the world. And everything that will happen in God's time, according to the time of life, God is in control of. That's why Jesus said to his disciples one day, take heed. In other words, beware. He says, watch and pray, for you know not when the time is. Beware, beware. Nothing is too hard for God, I tell you, but beware. There are forces out there trying their hardest to make it hard on you. But that's why this second word is so very important, and that is believe, right? beware, believe. Now, this is quite self-explanatory, so I won't spend too much time on this point, but you've got to believe. You see, the reason God knew he could ask Abraham this question and not worry about him giving a dissenting answer was because he knew Abraham had a record of believing God. Now, notice I did not say believing in God, but believing God. Not just believing who God is, but believing what God says. Believing God. God remembered when he told Abraham to pack up everything and leave your hometown. Go to a city which I shall show you and establish you and your descendants for endless generations. And with little hesitation, Abraham gathered his things and followed the Lord, not knowing what to expect or where he was going. He just believed God. And God did not lead him wrong. Oh, praise his name. And can I tell you, all you have to do is look back over your life. Think about how you made it this far. Come on, somebody. Think about how the Lord brought you through back then. Think about how he made a way out of no way before. Think about how he healed your body then. Think about how he saved your life. And guess what? If you believed then, you can believe now. You can believe now. Even when you didn't know what to do, what to say, where to go, or where you were going to end up, how many trusted God anyhow and can say it's only because of your belief in him that you made it through and you made it to where you are now? Oh, praise his name. I tell you, church, God has a way of honoring and rewarding your belief in him. In spite of what you may be going through or what may be going on around you, regardless of what you may see taking place on the outside, forget about what the enemy might be trying to show you to make you question you or your God. You've got to walk by faith and not by sight and believe that God is always able. He's always able. And then you'll come to the conclusion that the answer is still the same. There is nothing too hard for my God. Jesus again declared, if you can believe, come on, Bible readers, all things. Do I have a witness in here? All things, not some things, not most things, not a few things, but all things are possible. If you believe, I think somebody's almost there with me now, where you're not going to worry about a thing. Because I mean, no worry don't help you. It doesn't help you at all. The old folks used to say it's like a rocking chair. It give you something to do, but it don't get you nowhere. You just worry. But somebody might feel like me right now, where nothing is going to bother you to the point where you're just going to lose it and just lay down your religion and just give up. There's no doubt in your heart or in your mind in 20 forward that nothing is too hard for God. I hope I got a few witnesses in here. Somebody here, you see the signs of the time, even though you know you can't control the signs of the time. You hear God saying, beware. You believe. As you think about how God has never led you wrong before. Well, if you've got those two things taken care of, God is saying, finally, behold. That's the last word. Behold. In other words, here it is. Watch this. Notice what I'm about to do. A blessing is on the way. I hear him saying, my word is about to come true in your life. Behold. Behold. Church, the Lord made this promise to Abraham and Sarah in chapter 18. And then three chapters later, somebody say three chapters later. Something about that number three, if I knew. Something about that number three. Chapter 21, it opens saying, the Lord dealt with Sarah as he said. And the Lord did for Sarah as he had promised. Sarah conceived and bore Abraham a son in his old age. Here it is, though. At the time, I told you to put a bookmark there. At the time which God had said. Come on now. I need y'all to get with me now because, see, somebody's still doubting God a little bit. Chapter 18, he said, at the time Sarah shall surely bear a son. I will do what I said at the time. Chapter 21, it says, at the time which God had said, Abraham bore a son, Sarah bore a son in their, oh, let me try this again. Chapter 18, he said, you shall surely bear a son at the time when I return. At the time, you shall bear a son. Three chapters later, chapter 21, Sarah conceived, bore Abraham a son in his old age at the time which God said. I'm going to try one more time. Chapter 18. At the time, you shall surely bear a son. At the time, chapter 21, Abraham bore a son. Sarah had a child, however you want to put it, but it's at the time as God had said. Don't you tell me that my God does not keep his promises. Behold, I tell you, when you take heed of what you heard and you truly believe and have faith, you will behold the manifestation and fulfillment of the promises of our God. And you will see for sure that the answer is still the same. Nevertheless, in closing, lest I hold you too long, when we say we believe and then answer nothing's too hard, see, every time Pastor Junior preaches, I'm going to try to give you a challenge amidst the hope. I think it's not enough for us just to leave feeling better, but we need to leave trying to do better, trying to live better, trying to be better. When you say you believe and then you answer nothing's too hard, God then has to test our belief to see if we're just giving him lip service or if we really believe it in our hearts. And so God has to, here it is, test us before he blesses us. Let me say that one more time. God has to test you before he blesses you. Moreover, as God is testing, the enemy is tempting. All right? As God is testing us, the enemy is tempting us. But God's tests are to build us up and prepare us for what God has prepared for us. Whereas the devil's temptations are to break us down and prevent us from beholding or receiving what God has for us. And so sometimes when we're going through things that we don't understand and we cannot control, the devil wants to tempt us to doubt and to lose faith and to try to control it ourselves. But God is just trying to increase our faith in him. And he's testing us to see if we can put our life where our lips are. And actually practice what we profess. In other words, before we behold what God is about to do, we've got to uphold what he wants us to do. Tell somebody, uphold your side. Yeah, uphold your side of the bargain. Before we behold what God is about to do, we've got to uphold what he wants us to do. I've been telling you all month long, there is a part we must play in the plans God has for us. That's why, and I'm almost through, even though Abraham believed God was able to give him and Sarah this son, and the Lord did, God did not stop testing Abraham. And he did not stop testing Abraham because he wanted to see if his answer was still the same. He wanted to see if Abraham's answer was still the same. For you remember, come on, Bible readers, I need your help. He told Abraham to go sacrifice his own son Isaac on Mount Moriah. And he promised him that he would supply a ram to take his son's place. Abraham got up, Reverend Johnson. He did just what God said, and he simply took God at his word. And right before Abraham was about to just go through with the plan, not knowing if there was a ram anywhere or not, right in the nick of time, God said, "Lay not thine hand upon the lad. Lay not your hand upon your son, for behold, a ram is there caught in the thicket of the bush." Oh, praise the name our God. Right then and there, in keeping with God's time, God kept his word. Praise his holy name. Because Abraham believed, he then beheld God's blessings. He knew that if God said to do it, he was going to do it. And he trusted that God would keep his word. And so he beheld the blessings of the Lord. And I wonder today if anybody here has ever really beheld God's blessings. Have you ever beheld God step right in on time and work that thing out while you were trying to figure that thing out? Anybody here been through a test? But when you made it through, God gave you a testimony. Anybody here couldn't understand why God was allowing so much mess to come into your life? But now, when you look back over your life, behold, you see now how God was just using the mess in your life in order to bless your life. And now you can spread the message that there is nothing too hard for my God. Good God Almighty. I just need about 499 of y'all. I'll make 500. Who can say, "I don't care what I'm going through. Doesn't matter what the enemy tries to do. I'm not concerned with what anybody else may say." But the answer is still the same. There is nothing too hard for my God. It was the answer yesterday. It's the answer today. And no matter what problems tomorrow holds, it will be the answer tomorrow too. There is nothing too hard for my God. There's no problem too big for him to solve. No circumstance too difficult for him to change. No night too dark for him to brighten. No heart too broken for him to fix. I tell you, there's nothing too hard for my God. There's no question too confusing for him to answer. No crisis too critical for him to resolve. No miracle too impossible for him to perform. There's nothing too hard for my God. There's no mountain too steep for him to climb. No valley too wide for him to cross. cross. No road too rough for him to ride. No path too crooked for him to straighten. No spirit too low for him to uplift. No stomach too hungry for him to feed. No mind too messy for him to renew. And no head too down for him to raise. I tell you, there's nothing too hard for my God. There's no foe too fearful for him to conquer. No sorrow too deep for him to remove. No battle too fierce for him to win. No handicap too crippling for him to help. No disease too sickening for him to overcome. There's nothing too hard for my God. No emotions too hurt for him to heal. No storm too strong for him to steal. No child too lost for him to find. No person too lonely for him to comfort. No criminal too bad for him to pardon. No sinner too shameful for him to forgive. No need too much for him to meet. No soul too lost for him to find. And no life too dead for him to revive. There's nothing too hard for my God. Come on, Brooklyn, let's give it a try, because the answer is still the same. I've got a few questions for you. Will God let you down? Absolutely not. God will turn his back? Absolutely not. Will God leave you or forsake you? Absolutely not. Will God make a mistake? Will God break his promises to you? Is there anything too hard for God? Will God fail? Will God die? Will God lie? Will God lose? Absolutely not. There is nothing too hard for my God. That's why Jesus said, with men, some things are impossible, but with God, all things are possible. Oh, praise his name. I come to tell you that God can do anything. God can heal anything. God can fix anything. God can revive, renew, repair, restore, release, remove, redeem anything. How many know he'll do it? Can he do it? Didn't he do it? Won't he do it? Shout yes! 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 He'll do it, I tell you. There's nothing too hard for God. So keep on believing him. Keep on trusting him. Keep on waiting on him. And I promise you, the Lord will make a way somehow. So Lord told me to tell you, be not dismayed, whatever be tired. God will. I said, God will. God will. Praise him, Brooklyn. Praise him, Brooklyn. Praise him, Brooklyn. There's nothing too hard for him. Nothing too much for him. Nothing too difficult for him. The answer is still the same. Wanna do it? Wanna do it? If you know he'll do it, shout yeah. Shout yes! Shout yes! Yes! Cause see, this is my answer to his question. Yes! Yes! Yes, Lord! Whatever you want us to do, whatever you need us to do, yes, Lord. How many can tell the Lord my answer is still the same too? My answer is still the same too. God, if you want to use me, God, if you want me to go, God, if you want me to say it, God, if you want me to do it, because I know your answer is still the same. There's nothing too hard for you, then my answer is still the same as well. There's nothing too much that I can do for my God. I can do whatever God wants me to do. Come on, tell the Lord yes today. The door of the church is open. Tell the Lord yes. Stand to your feet if you're not already and if you're able. That's good, that's good, that's good. The door is open. There may be one who wants to respond to God with a yes, with a I will, with a I've got to, with a I want to be saved.
God is able to do just what he said he would do. Wonderful thing. Every
If you know he's able, sing it like you mean it. Show it like you believe it. He's able today. He's able today. He's able today. Come on, everybody say it. Everybody say it. God is able.
God is able to do just what he said he would do.
He's going to fulfill. Yes, Lord. Come on, tell somebody, don't give up on God. Don't give up on God. He won't. Hey! Yes, sir. Come on, come on, people of God. Believe him today. Trust him today. He's able. Yes, he is. 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 To your people, God, we believe you. Come on. Whoa. Whoa. We continue to play softly. The invitation to Christ, to a relationship with the Lord, is available right now. If you don't have a personal relationship with Christ, and as I told you on last Sunday, how can we know the way? It's not about a religion, it's about a relationship. It's about knowing Christ for yourself, knowing what God is able to do, knowing that God has a strength for every one of my weaknesses, knowing that God will pick me up when I fall, knowing that God will forgive me when I go wrong, knowing that God will cleanse me where I might be messy, knowing where God will work it out for me. It's a relationship. That's what it's all about. And you would want, and once you get in a relationship with him, you then ascribe to a religion about him so that you can worship him, glorify him, and grow in him. So again, if there isn't one who has a relationship with Christ, let today be your day. Let today be your day. Step out of that aisle. Step out on faith and give God your heart. Let the Lord in your life. Let the Lord in your life. Immediately following service, because there may be some in the balcony, immediately following service, Pastor King and I will be standing down here at the altar to receive anyone who wants to give their life to Christ and join not just the Brookland Baptist Church, but join the sheepfold of faith. Join the body of Christ. Because that's what it's about. Amen. Are there some names that we could that we need to pray for specifically? You see there that number, those of you in Brookland Beyond, that number for the invitation to discipleship. If you desire to unite with our church body, just put your name there, what your desire is, and Dr. King will make contact with you. But if you need special prayer, there's an intercessory prayer line number on the screen as well. But our intercessors are always wanting and willing to pray for you for whatever your need might be. So our prayer chapel will be available immediately following service as well. But let's keep these persons in our prayers. Miss Lorraine Brister and the pastor, passing of her son, Mr. Charles Williams. Also, Miss Janice Hall Alexander, Ernest Alexander. Was Ernest here today? Amen. But he's one of our faithful workers on our audiovisual team. Let's pray for Ernest and Miss Glenda in the passing of their husband and father. Also, Miss Karen Scott, who was my scout leader growing up here at Brookland. I talked and prayed with her the other day in the passing of her mother, Miss Gloria Scott. Let's pray for her. Amen. And if you need more information, if there isn't a name that's up there, amen, it may be listed on our website, www.brooklandbaptist.org. Let's go to God now in a word of prayer. Father, it's in the name of Jesus that we come before you right now with expectancy in our spirit, realizing, God, that at the beginning of this year of 20 forward, that you brought us here for a reason. You kept us for a purpose. You led us through it all, God, because you've got something else on your agenda for us. So, God, we're living in expectancy right now. We're walking in expectancy right now, God, knowing that there is more in store and that there is nothing too hard for you. And so, God, whatever it is that is on our mind, whatever it is that we're dealing with personally, God, whatever it is that we're praying for and we're wishing for and we're hoping for, we give it to you right now, God. God, you said you would hear, you would answer our prayers, and if we ask anything in Jesus' name, it shall be added unto us. You said if we delight ourselves in you, God, you would give us the desires of our heart. God, we're leaving today delighting in you, glorifying you, God, honoring you, God, admiring and adoring you, God, because we know that whatever you have for us, it is for us. So God, give us now the patience. Give us the strength to hold on. Give us the courage to wait, God. Give us the faith to believe that though we might not have it now, it's on the way. We praise you for it in advance now. We thank you in advance now because we know, God, that if you did it before, you can do it again. If you did it for others, you can do it for me too, God. And so we thank you now for what you have in store. Help us, God, to continue to be aware. Help us to believe you even more so that we will behold, God, what you have in store. That is our prayer. Now remember those names we called before you. You know what they stand in need of, God. Grant it now in the name of Jesus is our prayer. And now may the grace of God, the love of Jesus Christ, the sweet communion of the Holy Spirit rest, rule, and abide with all of us now, henceforth, and forevermore. And the people of God said amen. Try not to move. The Banquet and Conference Center was closed from 11 to 1, but it will reopen at 1 o'clock, is our understanding. We're welcoming the POTUS today, the President of the United States. I meant to make that announcement earlier, but I was caught up in the spirit. I wasn't thinking about no president or no politician. But yes, so I got to make that announcement. The President will be visiting us at the Banquet and Conference Center later this afternoon, but we would that you be patient as you enter into the conference center, because you may have to go through some security, amen, in order to get in and greet the president. We got another. All right. If you parked on Craft Street, now, you got to move it now. That announcement was made about 45 minutes ago, but it might get told now. You got to move it now. Amen. All right. God bless you. Go in peace. If you want to see the president this afternoon, you can do so. The conference center will open back at 1 o'clock. God bless you. May heaven smile upon you. And remember, the answer is still the same.